I think we're good now. All right, good morning. Welcome to worship at Well of Hope ELCA in Castle Rock, Colorado. And thank you for joining us both in person and online. I'm assuming online is working. Great. Okay. There's several things that have had some technical difficulties this morning. So as you can see, the TV is not on, and it is because for some reason it is not connecting. So we're going to use the bulletins for people that are in person. I think the PowerPoint is good for online people, but for in person we'll be using these. So raise your hand if you need a bulletin. We're good. All right, so if you are worshiping online, thank you so much for joining us, and please say hello in the chat. I think Patrick is going to be the online greeter this morning. Yeah, he'll be the online greeter this morning. So so go ahead and say hello, and Patrick will say hello to you and welcome you to worship on Facebook. A note about restrooms, there are restrooms located in the back of this room as well as around the church, so feel free to get up and use those. We have a digital bulletin if you would like to use it. The code does not appear, but they are posted in the back, but I don't think anyone really needs it this morning since we have these, but it is there in case you would like to use it. A special thank you to those who have signed up to help with worship. There are still roles that need to be filled, and the last time I checked, the row for next week is completely blank. So if you are going to be here next week and are willing to help out to be an assisting minister or a reader, a fellowship host, we would love to have you do that. And so please take a look at that sign-up sheet and consider signing up, especially for next week. A note about a Synod Assembly this year. It is actually going to be happening in El Paso, Texas from May 16th to the 18th. And we are looking for a couple people from Well of Hope to attend Synod Assembly and represent Well of Hope. So if you're interested in attending this event, please talk to me, and I will get you some information about registration and more details about the event. But we would love to have a few folks from Well of Hope participate and represent at this event. So please talk to me if you're interested. If you have any prayer requests that you would like to have read during the prayers of the people, you can place them in this basket. Up here anytime before the prayers of the people, and we will be sure that we get those read. And Carol has an announcement about outreach.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning online. Good to sort of see you. Hi. For the Sundays of Lent during the month of March, Well of Hope is supporting the ELCA Good Gifts program by raising money to buy farm animals. This can help families break the cycle of poverty and hunger forever and also impact whole villages once one family gets this opportunity. If we can reach a total of $715, we can buy the whole farm, which would be an exciting thing because it includes animals, seeds, tools, and agricultural training. But whatever you can donate along the way will help. There's a poster back on the table there that shows you how much each animal is worth, so to speak. So if you make a donation in a certain amount, you don't have to specify that it goes for that animal, but it'll give you an idea what that will buy for a family. We'll keep you updated on the progress in a couple of weeks, and then we'll give a final total on Palm Sunday, April 2nd. If you'd like to be part of this, make your check payable to Well of Hope, put buy farm animals in the memo line, and you can also give online, either at Vanco or on the website, choosing support our ministry, and you'll find an option to buy farm animals. You'll see the picture of the animals there to help you find the right spot. So thank you. I hope everybody will enjoy being part of this, and we'll give you a progress report in a couple weeks. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Carol. And I also have an announcement from Patty Eline. Would you like me to make the announcement?
Sure.
Okay. All right, so Patty, who is back here, She is going to be collecting small toiletries that you can get from hotels while you're on trips, and these will be donated to the Bill Daniels Veterans Center. And so these shampoos and soaps and other toiletries will be offered to homeless veterans to use to shower at the center. So we're asking everyone in the coming weeks, this will, I guess, go on continuously, is that right, Patty? Okay, to just bring in these items, and Patty will bring them over to the center. And Kathy, would you like to make an announcement?
We would like you to reserve the last Sunday of March, March 26th, as a time for Michael appreciation. And we're going to have a little celebration that day, and certainly we'll have some delicious fellowship items. But put that on your calendar. Be great to see people in person that day, and we will just give him our well wishes and our thank yous.
All right, and that is all the announcements. Yes, Chris has an announcement.
Just to tag on to the Senate Assembly, Well of Hope can cover transportation costs. So if anybody's interested, we can cover that.
Perfect. So for those online who might not have heard, Well of Hope can cover transportation costs for the Senate Assembly. So if you are interested, that cost can be covered for you. Are there any other announcements? All right, well then let us quiet our hearts and minds, and we will begin with our call to worship.
Days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and for God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt, though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen.
Lord of reconciliation, you heal our wounds in darkest times. Kyrie eleison. In the midst of fear and violence, make our lives a prayer of peace.
Hear the good news. God so loved the world. and comes to us in Christ so that all may receive life. The promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, our leader and guide, in the waters of baptism, you bring us to new birth to live as your children. Strengthen our faith in your promises, that by your Spirit we may lift up your life to all the world through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. I invite the kids to come join us for this morning's time with the children. Come on up, everybody.
About that verse, and wondering how much God loves us and if we can measure it. So I've brought some measuring tools. So I have my watch, I have a measuring cup, I have a tape measure, and I want to see if we can figure out if we can measure how much God loves us. So sometimes I need to measure ingredients. Like if I'm making cookies, I might need to measure how much flour I need or how many chocolate chips. Which tool do you think I would use for that? Yeah, I'd probably use the measuring cup. I wonder if I could use a measuring cup to measure God's love. I'm going to look in the Bible and see. This Bible verse says that God is my shepherd. God takes care of me, and my cup overflows. Oh, so if my cup overflows, do you think I can use that to measure God's love? No, it's not big enough. My cup would overflow. Okay. What about if I'm building something? I need to measure how long it is. Yeah, I'd use a tape measure so that I could measure maybe how long I need it to be or how tall it should be. See if we can use a measuring tape to measure God's love. Let's see, this Bible verse says, "For great is your love, God. It's higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies." If God's love is all the way up to the skies, do you think my measuring tape will be long enough?
No.
No, probably not. I don't think I can use that measuring tape to measure God's love. Okay, well, what about if I need to see what time it is or measure how long I have until lunchtime or how long I have to get ready? What tool would I probably use?
The clock.
Yeah, a watch or a clock. Let's see if we can use a clock to measure God's love. It's the Bible says that from everlasting to everlasting, God's love is with God's people. That means God's love is forever. Do you think my clock and my watch could measure forever?
No.
No, probably not. I don't know that we can measure God's love. I'm going to go back to my favorite Bible verse that I was talking about that's in our reading today. It says, "For God loved the world so much that God gave us Jesus, God's Son, so that whoever believes in Jesus will not be lost, but have eternal life." That's a kind of love that's too big to measure. And the good news is we don't need to measure it. We just get to enjoy it. Dear God,
thank you for your love.
Thank you for your love.
A love so great.
A love so great.
You gave your only Son.
You gave your only Son.
So that we could have eternal life.
So that we could have eternal life.
Amen.
Amen.
Our first reading today is from Genesis chapter 12. It's a short one, so try not to blink. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Word of God. Word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise in body or spirit for the gospel acclamation.
Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I've told you about earthly things and you not, do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Please be seated. And dear friends at Well of Hope ELCA, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. When I was younger, when I was a lot younger, I used to talk with my colleagues who were also doing youth ministry about what was the best way to help our young people inherit a faith that is deep and wise and lasting. And one of the questions we used to ask often was, is the Christian faith something that's primarily taught, or is it something that's primarily caught? You know, and those of us who kind of leaned towards the taught side of that equation would develop these great catechism programs to let our middle school students really probe the depths of our faith, and these deep Bible studies to let our high school kids wrestle with the meaning of being a follower of Jesus. We really wanted them to know all the basics of the Christian faith, to really understand it in a way that would stay with them for the rest of their lives. You know, my wife grew up in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, and she said that her three years of catechism was actually the best college prep work she ever did. There are those of us who really value understanding what our faith's all about and being able to talk in ways that are very helpful and wise about God. The folks who leaned over towards the cot side of that equation, though, they spent a lot more time in places like bowling alleys or like the mini golf course that our kids are going to this afternoon. And they did that not just to goof around with kids, but they did that because of their belief that if our young people could spend time in the presence of thoughtful and faithful adults, people who were able to live in a gracious way, people who were able to love in very, very deep ways, people who tried to sort of represent Christ in everything that they said and they did, that the kids would catch the spirit of what it means to live the Christ life. So what is it about the Christian faith? Is it something that's primarily taught or something that's primarily caught? That question really kind of lies just below the surface in our gospel lesson this morning. It's an interesting conversation that St. John reports to us that Jesus had with a man named Nicodemus. Now, Nicodemus was a trained religious scholar. He was a Pharisee. He had worked his way up to the top of the Jewish hierarchy to where he was a member of the Jewish council in Jerusalem. It's interesting that none of the other gospel writers seem to know anything at all about Nicodemus, but he's important enough to St. John that he appears three times in John's gospel. Nicodemus, as Jesus says in the lesson this morning, is one who has been trained to teach the people of Israel. You know, he's likely studied under all the best rabbis that were available. He's become known for his wisdom and his insight about the faith. He's worked his way up to the top of the hierarchy, is really a leader in Jerusalem. And if there's anybody in those days who should really have a sense as to what God was up to, it probably was somebody like Nicodemus. And that's why this conversation is so odd, so puzzling. It begins really well, doesn't it? I mean, he says to Jesus, we know that you're a man of God. Nobody could possibly do the stuff that you do if they weren't connected with God. And then Jesus immediately kind of begins to challenge him and says to Nicodemus that nobody can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Well, this is a little puzzling to Nicodemus, and he asks, well, how is it that when you're as old as I am, you could possibly go back and be born again? And Jesus pushes it a little farther then. He says, nobody will enter the kingdom of God unless they're born both of water and of spirit. And Nicodemus, by this time, is just at his wit's end. And it's an interesting thing, isn't it? I mean, it seems as though one of the greatest scholars of the time is trying to learn from one of the greatest teachers who's ever lived and really isn't having much luck. And the interesting thing about this passage, I think, is what Jesus says to Nicodemus. I want to read it to you so that I get it right. Jesus says to Nicodemus, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who's born of the Spirit. It's interesting to see here that Jesus is trying to teach and mentor Nicodemus into a new way of being faithful. And it's the kind of ministry that Jesus conducts with people over and over and over again through his journey. He respects the knowledge that Nicodemus has amassed, but Jesus sees that there's something that he's missing, a spark within him, the movement of the Spirit that could help him to explore what it means to be connected with God in much deeper ways than just the information that he's gathered along the way. But Nicodemus hasn't yet quite captured that. If you read through the 7th chapter and the 20th chapter of John, you'll find out that Nicodemus is one who does eventually get it. But it's interesting to see here that Jesus kind of seems to affirm that the Christian faith is something that is both taught and something that is caught. And that's why people like Lexi and old guys like me used to do a lot of work at developing strong lesson plans to help our young people understand the faith better, but also create those opportunities where the Spirit might blow into their lives and deepen their faith and their relationship with God. I still think this is an awfully good question for the church, and not just when we're dealing with young people, but for the whole life of the church. How is it that we live into this notion that Christian faith is both taught and caught? I think of our own Lutheran tradition, how we've tried for so many years to develop understandings of God that let us speak about God in wise and thoughtful ways. But at the same time, we've worked really hard to create worship services that we find to be deeply meaningful and touch people at the very core of who they are. I think of Well of Hope, a people of God who seem very serious about the Word of God and studying it and embracing it and understanding what our ancestors have learned, but who also take particular delight in those moments when we're able to see the face of Christ in the person we serve. And maybe we think about that in our own lives as well, especially during this season of Lent, during this journey where we try to live into the disciplines of Lent, in a way learn to live more deeply into the life of faith. How is it that we in these past days have been studying the Word of God maybe a little bit more diligently than we usually do? Or perhaps finding opportunities where we can experience the presence of Christ in our life as it connects us and moves through us to touch others. So that, of course, brings us to the question that I'll be asking probably every Sunday this season. How's your Lent going so far? Well, we're 10 days into it. And for those of us who are keeping track at home, that's 25% of the season. What are those ways that we've spent a little more energy digging into God's Word during these 40 days? What are those ways that we've been trying to open our hearts up to the way that God is moving among us and wants to stir us to deeper faith? You know, the life of the Christian is a life that we embrace as we're taught and as it catches us, as it gathers us up into the grace and the mercy and the love of God, and so grounds us in the promises of Christ that it frees us up to love God, serve God, to love all and to serve all. And in doing so, the Spirit blows into our lives, blows through our lives, that we and others might continue to experience the presence of Christ that lives and moves among us today. Amen.
Please rise, embody your spirit for our song of the day, Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. Holy God, you so love your church. Raise up leaders who care for your people. Bless lay theologians, seminary, and college professors, and all who are called to the ministry of teaching, that they form and inspire us for the work of the gospel. Merciful God, Creator God, you so love your creation. Breathe new life into our planetary home. Guide the work of researchers, scientists, and activists who love your Earth and who inspire us to care for the natural world. Merciful God, Mighty God, you so love the world. Uphold leaders who resist tyranny and oppression. Strengthen organizations that promote peace and harmony. Direct their work to alleviate human suffering and to address its root causes. Merciful God, compassionate God, you so love your people. Draw near to all who live with mental illness, depression, or addiction, and accompany them in healing and recovery. Hear the cries of those who look to you in their distress. We especially pray for healing for Kirsten and Dave. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Faithful God, you so love your children. Bless the young in our midst and delight us with their joy, wonder, and curiosity. Revive our ministries with children and youth and equip us all for faithful discipleship. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Eternal God, you so love your saints. As our ancestors in the faith have been a blessing to us, so inspire us by their example of holy living to be a blessing to those who come after us. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. We encourage you to share a greeting of God's peace. Those of you who are gathered with us in person to be seated as we receive this morning's offering, and we welcome those of you who join us online to visit the Well of Hope website, where you too can find some ways that you can offer your financial support to support the work of this ministry. Invite you, if you are able, to stand with us as we prepare to receive the presence of Christ in this meal. Let us pray. God of good gifts, receive these and all our offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you to mercifully accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Come as you are and receive the presence of Christ in this meal. For the gifts of God are. We invite the congregation to be seated and come forward as you are ready. We invite those who are joining us online to share bread and wine wherever you are with the words, the body of Christ, the blood of Christ. And we know that together we share this meal in which Christ meets us today.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Embodied God, at your table we have tasted the goodness of Jesus. With the eyes of our hearts open to your promise, empower us to hear the needs of our neighbors and touch the world with your love. Amen.
Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and through grace gave us eternal comfort and good hope, comfort your hearts and strengthen them in every good work and word. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Amen.
Please join me for our sending song, How Great is Our God.
Us and sends us in mission to the world. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, thank you so much for worshiping with us this morning. Great to have you who are here in person and you have joined us online. We hope to see you all next Sunday as well. We invite those who are here in this room to be seated as Mel comes forward and shares with us this morning another update from our transition team. While Mel's coming up, maybe we should say thank you to Lexi and Patrick for leading us in worship this morning. Michael is off on a trip to celebrate the birthday of his grandmother, and so our prayers are with him as he travels as well.
Good morning, I'm Mel Salzenberg.
Good morning,
I'm a member of the transition team. You know, we are very thankful for this team. It's a diverse and committed team. And if you have any input to share with us, please do. We need to hear from everyone. We spent the past this with our spiritual, our engagement, and the miracle book for that matter. And so now is the time when all the members of the transition team who are here, would you please stand and please feel free to get all of us at any time.
Oh. Come on.
Did you forget? So thank you all. And thank you all for your input.
Thanks, guys.
There's lots of goodies on the table. We hope you stick around and have some time.